Hi, everybody. This is Crystal Proxmire of Oakland County Times, and we're here today with Tom Barrett, who is running for Congress in the 7th District. How are you today?
I'm great. Thank you. And thank you for giving me the opportunity to interview with you today.
Well, thanks for being here. Can you tell us just a little bit, where is the 7th District? Because this is a new district for people.
It is, you're right. And with the new changes to redistricting that takes place after every census, there's a process by which they draw the district boundaries for each of these districts. And in Michigan, we are losing a congressional district. We're going from the 14 that we have presently down to 13, which is a reflection of the fact that Michigan has not kept pace in our population growth with a number of other states that have outpaced us. So we have lost a congressional district in Michigan as a result. And where I am running in the new 7th congressional district is basically an area around the city of Lansing. It includes, Lansing is sort of the central point, if you will, geographically to this congressional district. It includes all the remainder of Ingham County, where Lansing is located, and most of the surrounding counties. So that's Eaton, Clinton, Shiawassee, and Livingston County, as well as South Lyon and Milford in Oakland County. And there is about maybe 100 households or so in Genesee County that are also included. But really the population density, if you will, is sort of the greater Lansing area, and then reaching as far as a few communities in Oakland County as well.
So why have you decided to run?
Well, I serve currently in the Michigan Senate, and I'm in my fourth year in the Michigan Senate. And prior to that, I served two terms in the Michigan House of Representatives. And really, though, my background beyond that is in the Army. That's what I've done my entire adult life since I graduated from high school. I took the very first airplane ride of my life when I graduated and embarked on a journey that's lasted 22 years long, and just retired this March. And I've served overseas in Iraq, Kuwait, Guantanamo Bay, and South Korea. Had many different opportunities in the Army, served abroad in many different places. Ultimately got selected to attend flight school in the Army and learned to fly some really amazing helicopters with an opportunity that the Army gave me that I never would have had otherwise in my life. And earlier, last year in August, when President Biden was withdrawing troops from Afghanistan, when I witnessed that devastation that led directly resulting in 13 Marines being killed, in my opinion, due to a dereliction of duty of our president, allowing the Taliban to be placed in charge of security for our troops, directly resulting in those fatalities, as well as a multitude of injuries to troops that were present in that haphazard and really unplanned or not well-planned withdrawal from Afghanistan. I fully believe that we needed to leave Afghanistan, that the time we had been there was longer than we should have been. But when you do that, you don't just forfeit the game on the way out the door. You don't let the Taliban be placed in charge of the lives of, 20-year-old Marines who are serving their country over there and just doing their best to do their mission. And President Biden allowed that to happen. There's been zero accountability in our federal government for any of the individuals responsible for that. General Milley, our chairman of the Joint Chiefs, Lloyd Austin, the current Secretary of Defense, the CENTCOM commander, no one has been held accountable for that. And it was really something that I felt so strongly and objectionable about that it really started to motivate me around running for Congress to do something about that. And since then, and really it started before then, but has been much more exacerbated since, has been the issues of inflation. There's just been crippling middle class and working class families throughout our country, and really here in the area that I'm looking to represent, in the area that I live in and do represent in the Michigan Senate now. And then issues of gasoline and other just real life necessities that have been devastating. On top of that, we have fentanyl pouring in across our southern border in a totally unrestricted way, and is now the leading cause of death of people my age, unfortunately, and devastating and sadly in our country. And crime is just rampant now in our country. Lansing, Michigan, our capital city in Michigan, is now the 9th most dangerous city in the country. Lansing shattered their record, their historical average for murders, and in 2021 set their highest number of murders ever on record. That's something that, we can't ignore. I couldn't look around and pretend these things weren't happening. I couldn't pretend that our posture abroad wasn't weakened because of weak leadership here at home domestically with our president. And then I looked at this new congressional district that's been drawn, and I realized I can do something about this. I represent a third of the people that are in this congressional district already. in virtually all of the district I represent in Lansing. All of the nearly all of the 275,000 people I represent are included within this new congressional district. And Alyssa Slotkin, my opponent in this race, has been a direct enabler for these policies by President Biden, voting with him for 100% of his policies. And she will probably come on your program and talk about how bipartisan and moderate she is, but her voting record, which is her ultimate and paramount responsibility as a member of Congress, has been in direct alignment with President Biden, leading exactly to the outcomes that we've seen that I find so objectionable.
So you mentioned having served in the military and some of that experience. Can you just talk a little bit more about your professional experience and what skills you bring to the table?
Sure. So I was elected to the Michigan House of Representatives in 2014. I ran because at the time, Michigan had the second highest veteran unemployment rate in the entire country. And I firsthand witnessed friends of mine, people I had served with, served alongside of, and folks, some of whom had gone to flight school with me and learned this, you know, amazing skill set that the Army teaches you to be able to learn to fly helicopters, something that not many people have that opportunity to do, that takes a great deal of focus, concentration, and aptitude. And they were unable to find work back home in Michigan. And as I said, we had the second highest veteran unemployment rate at the time. The post 9/11 veteran unemployment rate was even higher than that. And I thought, you know, I can continue to complain about this or I can do something about it. At the time, I was working as an analyst for the state treasurer and working in different professional capacities there. I stepped up to run for the House of Representatives and I won my seat that year very narrowly and got elected as the only Iraq War veteran in the Michigan House of Representatives. The Speaker of the House at the time appointed me to chair the Committee on Military and Veteran Affairs in the State House. We moved a variety of different veteran legislative efforts through the House of Representatives, through the legislature, signed into law by Governor Snyder at the time. I was reelected in 2016. We took on the issue of investigating the fraud and abuse and issues taking place of understaffing and chronic abuse at the Grand Rapids Home for Veterans. We took that on and spearheaded that effort to reform that there. They've since had a vastly improved quality of service that they're offering our veterans. I was reelected to the House of Representatives in 2016, elected to the Michigan Senate in 2018, and now I serve as the only Iraq War veteran in the Michigan Senate, where I continue to take on a lot of these issues as well as a variety of many others. I've had dozens of bills that have been signed into law by governors of both parties, Governor Snyder certainly as a Republican, Governor Whitmer as a Democrat, that handle a whole bunch of issues in our state and were passed in very substantial bipartisan majorities.
So if you're elected and make it to Washington, what are some of the things that you'd like to work on?
Well, we've got a lot of issues that we're facing in our country right now, and it's hard to focus on only one or two or three. A lot of the issues that I pointed out that were motivations for me to run in the first place are the issues that we need to tackle. We have an unaffordable cost of living now for families, working families and middle-class families in our country, of which my wife and I, we are raising four kids and we're a middle-class family doing our best to raise four children. And everything we see now is more expensive, whether that's groceries or even the cost of transportation to put gas in our tank and get our kids to the activities they're involved in, get to school in the morning or back home. All of those are becoming devastatingly more expensive for families across mid-Michigan where I'm looking to represent. And those are the issues that we need to start to focus on and tackle, as well as securing our border. That is not just an issue of crime and of drugs and of fentanyl and other issues, but it's also a national security issue as well. We don't know who is coming into our country. And with the lifting of Title 42, as President Biden is seeking to do, that could lead to tens of thousands of people entering the country every single day. We already have record-setting numbers of border crossings taking place illegally at our southern border, and that would only make the problem worse. And that's something that I stand in stark opposition to President Biden on, and something that I will firmly oppose when I'm elected to Congress. In addition to that, we've got to invest more in law and order in our country. We have to enable our police to do their jobs and keep our communities safe. And we also need to address issues of energy independence. Gasoline is $5.50 a gallon throughout Michigan right now. I sponsored legislation that would waive the sales tax on gasoline. Michigan's one of the only states in the nation that, in addition to charging a fuel tax for every gallon, we also stick people and motorists with a sales tax on top of that. And to me, that's an unfair enrichment of government right now, because as the cost of gasoline goes up, the amount that is charged in tax also goes up. And government shouldn't be getting rich on the backs of working class and middle class folks here in Michigan just trying to get by. We have to get energy independent. We have to open pipelines in our country to move energy more efficiently, more safely, and more reliably around our country that gives access to energy to people. Not everybody can afford an electric vehicle like Debbie Stabenow has suggested, or many others in the federal administration, Jennifer Granholm and others who've really, frankly, cackled at all of us who simply cannot afford an electric vehicle and made us feel like somehow we're inadequate or not doing our part, when in turn, we should actually be expanding our energy footprint here in our country, making us energy independent and allowing us to export that energy to allies of ours in Europe that make them then less beholden to people like Vladimir Putin.
So in this race, you don't have an opponent for the primary, but you will be facing a Democrat in November. Why should the voters pick you?
Well, as I pointed out, you know, the priorities that I laid out are the priorities for families across Michigan. And they're the priorities that I hear about when I see folks at church, at the grocery store, when I'm dropping my kids off for school or activities or picking them up. And as I'm out and about in our community, I live in this district. I have lived here and raised a family here. My opponent just moved to this district a few weeks ago. I moved here just after I returned home from Iraq when my wife and I got married. She was already a resident of this area, and we moved to this community where we're raising a family now. I bought my house 4 days after I came home from Iraq and got married just about a week after that. So my wife had planned our wedding while I was deployed, and I came home. We bought our house, got married all very quickly after I returned back home. And now we're raising a family in this community. My opponent, meanwhile, has lived the majority of her life not even in Michigan and in Washington, D.C. for a great deal of that time, and now has just moved to this district a few weeks ago to desperately try and position herself in a way that looks sincere to the voters in this district. You know, I don't need to pretend to be somebody I'm not. People already know me in this district. They voted for me. Despite the fact that the district that I represent now was one that was carried by Governor Whitmer in 2018, I won my seat in the state Senate by double-digit margins that year because the people in my district trust me to be their voice and their advocate. I also have a very independent voting record. I have voted against my own party leadership in Lansing more than 280 times. I'm willing to really look at issues on their merits and vote according to what I think is appropriate. And the last thing I'll say is I'm not somebody who is going to mislead the voters of this district. I'm a conservative. I don't make any pretense not to be, because I believe the solutions to the problems we're facing in our country right now are best found by conservative principles and conservative solutions. My opponent, in the meantime, will tell you that she is a moderate, bipartisan, and independent figure, but her actual voting record is one of 100% alignment with Joe Biden and 99% with Nancy Pelosi. Those are not the solutions to the problems we're facing. I offer a contrast to that, and it's why I'm running, and I hope to earn the confidence of the voters of this district, and that they'll see the experience that I have and the character that I have that will allow them to trust me with their vote and represent them in Washington, D.C. now.
So if those voters want to know more about you and your campaign, where can they go?
Absolutely. They can go to tombarrettforcongress.com. That's my website for my campaign. And we are going to be out and about in a lot of different summer festivals, parades, activities. We have people out door to door. I'm going to be in and out of doing different door to door solicitation as well, both, you know, in all parts of this district. It's a big area to cover. It's 780,000 people or so. So it's a lot of folks. I probably won't be able to meet each and every one of them individually, but it is something that I think the message of what we are running on and the issues that are so important right now, that we cannot continue down this road that we're on. People are welcome to come and visit us on our website and request a yard sign, anything else to help us win this race. We would deeply appreciate that. And I would deeply and sincerely appreciate their vote to earn their trust to be their member of Congress in Washington, D.C.
Great. Well, thank you so much for taking the time to do the interview with us today.
Thank you for having me. I really appreciate it.